You are listening to Christian Audio's production of Seeing the Voice of God, What God is Telling You Through Dreams and Visions by Laura Harris Smith. This book is read by me, Laura Harris Smith. This audio recording was produced in 2014 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition issued by contractual arrangement with Baker Publishing Group, originally published by Baker Publishing Group, in English, as Seeing the Voice of God, What God is Telling You Through Dreams and Visions, copyright 2012 by Laura Harris Smith, all rights reserved. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio, to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles. For Sheila, who smiled and listened to everything I first saw.
This is Dr. James Gall, and I'm the director of Encounters Network and Prayer Storm. I'm the author of The Seer, Dream Language, The Lifestyle of a Prophet, and other books, and I'm bringing to you The Foreword. I am constantly on the search for next generation voices that carry content full of the Word of God, walk in present day anointing of the Holy Spirit, and have character to carry the gift. One of these leaders is Laura Harris Smith. She is a godly woman with her priorities straight. Living in the Nashville region now, for the past several years, I have become a friend and advisor to Eastgate Creative Christian Fellowship, which Chris and Laura Smith co-lead. It is a passionate, spirit-filled church cultivating the arts as an expression of the faith. And I shout a loud amen to that. Balance with an edge. Seeing the Voice of God is a prophetic, progressive book with the cutting edge of truth, yet filled with so much scripture and life experience that it is uniquely balanced as well. So I call this a book with balance with an edge. Looking for a source that is biblically centered? Looking for an author who lives her message? Looking to be stretched out of your present comfort zone into the new light of the Holy Spirit? Then look no further. You're holding a balanced book with a sharp edge. Impartation. If you want to grow in the area of dreams and visions, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and especially discerning of spirits, then your wait is over. Listening, waiting, and watching are keys to growth in the things of the Holy Spirit. The following scripture exemplifies the content in this book. For from days of old they have not heard, nor perceived by ear, nor has the eye seen a God besides you who acts in behalf of the one who waits for him. Isaiah 64, verse 4, from the New American Standard Version. Notice the emphasis in this great word. Eyes, ears, are filled with the revelation of the Holy Spirit. After all, God acts on behalf of the one who waits for him. Impartation happens when we cooperate with his ways. God acts on behalf of the one. Who is that one? God is the equal opportunity employer. That one he acts on behalf of can be you. Yes, you can come into the new level of activity of the Holy Spirit. fruit that remains. The one thing I know for sure is that Laura Harris Smith wants to see fruit that remains for the glory of God. Learn the hindrances and move forward with keys to greater growth. From a deep place of esteem, it is my great honor to commend to you the life, the ministry, and now the writings of Laura Harris Smith. May your eyes see and may your ears hear the word of the Lord for such a time as this.
Chapter 1. Is God Ever Silent? It was early 1997, and I had a choice to make and about 10 seconds in which to make it. I was in North Carolina at Chimney Rock State Park near Asheville, and my hike up to the top of Hickory Nut Falls had temporarily separated me from the rest of the pack when I decided to dart into a small recessed craggy cave. But it was not just any cave. It was the famous cave behind the 404-foot waterfall featured in the final minutes of the 1992 epic film, The Last of the Mohicans. The cave that the entire all-star cast filed into to hide, resulting in a heart-stopping escape that required jumping through the falls from the backside and plummeting into the river below. I stood there looking at the backside of the waterfall, which was about 15 feet in front of me, and within seconds I was damp from the deafening mist. There was no guardrail, no attendant, and most dangerously, none of my family standing there telling me not to go for it, the way they do when I express my desire to go skydiving. I could not believe the peace and fearlessness I felt. It was not as if I did not know where I would land, because just before heading up the mountain, I had passed right by it. All of a sudden, it was not 404 feet in my mind, but just 5 seconds, tops. So that I could get a running start, I backed up a few feet, and without a moment's hesitation, I was off. I do not even remember hitting the wall of water, just the fall. Arms and legs flailing, it felt like 5 minutes of free fall, not 5 seconds. But the rush was indescribable. And then it happened, what I wish had not. I woke up. But just before I did, on the way down in the dream, I had heard a booming voice say, "You are going to have a great fall." It is actually what had jolted me awake, not the cold river itself, which I had never reached. I sat up in bed with a gasp and immediately shook Chris, my level-headed husband. Foregoing the cinematic details, I told him about the booming voice in the waterfall, which gave new meaning to John the Revelator's words. His voice was like the sound of many waters, Revelation 1:15. Fearfully, I repeated what I heard. "You are going to have a great fall." Without even opening his eyes, Chris calmly said, "Autumn, Laura, you're going to have a great autumn." Then he rolled over and went back to sleep. That precise interpretation instantly took me back to the misty peace and fearlessness I had felt just before my leap of faith about 5 seconds and 404 feet before. It was indeed a great fall that year, and knowing it was coming made the hard summer more tolerable as autumn began to unfold, play by play, following that riveting dream. The adrenalized leap of faith I had experienced at the waterfall, which I later discovered integrated a man-made set in the movie for internal cutaway shots to the cave scenes, perfectly mirrored the plunge we had taken about a month before the dream, when Chris had made the decision to leave his corporate job after a successful, nearly two-decade music career in the Christian music industry. The emotions of the jump were the same as in the dream. Peace and fearlessness on the front end, and giddy terror immediately following. God had told us to trust Him and jump, but counting all the additional perks and public opportunities, like TV appearances, that came with His job, it meant going from a six-digit income to zero overnight. Not to mention that we had 5 children, the 6th being born during our free fall. I start with that waterfall dream because it is a classic prophetic dream. Vivid during, stirring afterward, and just plain old pesky. Whether it is an encouragement, a warning, apocalyptic in nature, or just giving practical life direction, a prophetic dream has a gnawing drawing. You cannot shake it. We will discuss the various types of prophetic dreams in chapters 2 and 3. But the most important thing to remember is that they are invitations. the Holy Spirit Himself is handing you a written invitation to seek Him for interpretation, for application, for motivation. Just as light can eventually produce sound, a true prophetic illumination during the night will talk to you all day long. I call my waterfall dream a prophetic dream, but before we delve further into exactly what that means, let me just say this about personal dreaming. One of the standard definitions when discussing prophecy, or prophets in the Hebrew language, is the word nabi, whose Arabic root word naba means to announce. Thus, a personal prophetic dream is merely God announcing something He is hoping to do through, for, or to you. After trudging through a financially trying summer, I decided to start my great fall, the autumn of 1997, off right in anticipation of God's promise in my waterfall dream. We felt He had directed us to start a Christian management company with a vast artisan roster, not just musicians, but also actors, artists, dancers, and more. And while we already had one solid artist generating revenue, it was not enough to feed our huge family. We wondered why God was not speaking and telling us what to do. Were our ears clogged? Was He playing hide and seek? I started noticing swarms of Christian books being published on what to do when God is silent. It really started the wheels turning in my head. Was God truly ever silent? Who wants to serve a God who will not talk to them? Did He really see me down here begging for answers and just turn His head and ignore me? If so, I had to figure out why. If not, then all these books on a muted God had to deeply sadden Him. I had to know. 5 days. More than 5% of the world's population is deaf or has disabling hearing loss, an estimated 360 million people. But ask any Christian, and 100% of us will admit to experiencing disabling spiritual deafness, a much more startling figure. Undoubtedly, you have experienced seasons when the heavens were bronze and God seemed silent. These seasons are dangerous to the heart because they can cause it to wander and waver. And that is exactly where I was headed. Proverbs 13:12 says it best, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life." Finally, while praying one day, I heard God's voice. But He spoke the most random phrase that had nothing to do with the answers I needed. I heard, 5 days. All at once, and I do mean all at once, this plan just laid itself out in front of me, accompanying the random phrase. I felt God saying that I was somehow going to read the Bible in 5 days, and that I was going to do it with one question in mind. Is God ever silent? I would not do it to study any doctrinal or historical context along the way, but just to see if God ever took an uncommunicative posture with mankind. It was as though He was going to settle this in my mind once and for all by taking me through the totality of Scripture to see how He interacted with every now famous Bible character. When the answers you need are big, no self-help book will do. You have to go to the author of authors. But aside from wondering how on earth a mom of then five could steal away for that long, and aside from wondering how on earth a person could read the Bible in 5 days, there was the other question of where I would go to do this, for free. My father had just built a tiny prayer cabin in the woods on his 250-acre farm, and he agreed that I could be his first guest. Before leaving the farm, I did an experiment and timed myself by reading one average-sized Bible chapter to see if this goal was even feasible, because it sure seemed impossible to me. It took a little over 2 minutes for one chapter. Of course, some chapters are longer, but others are shorter, like Psalm 117, which is 2 verses long and contains fewer than 30 words. I then multiplied that 2 1/4 minutes by 1,189, the number of chapters within the 66 Bible books. The time came out only to 44 3/4 hours. That meant only a 9-hour reading day over 5 days, which was really no different from working a 40-hour work week. I was thrilled at this attainable goal. Here's how it panned out in the end. Day 1, read Genesis through Numbers, 153 chapters, at approximately 2 1/4 minutes each, equals 5 3/4 hours. Day 2, read Deuteronomy through Esther, 283 chapters, at approximately 2 1/4 minutes each, equals 10.5 hours. Day 3. Read Job through Ezekiel, 414 chapters at approximately 2.25 minutes each, equals 15.5 hours. Day 4. Read Daniel through Acts, 196 chapters at approximately 2.25 minutes each, equals 7.5 hours. Day 5. Read Romans through Revelation, 143 chapters at approximately 2.25 minutes each, equals 5.5 hours. Total, 66 books, 1,189 chapters, in 44.75 hours within 5 days. I did not chew on each verse, but read continuously, stopping only to write in a journal about any passages related to God's mouth or man's ears. God had given me this insatiable desire to read through the Bible with one question in mind. Is God ever silent? The books dealing with this topic were selling like hotcakes, and it seemed to me that they were putting words in God's mouth out of a desperation in a hearing drought. I wondered if God was frustrated at the assumption that he would zip his lip and withhold direction from us. I found that contradictory to his benevolent nature. My hopeful hunch was that these authors were using such titles as a tease, and then leading their readers through steps on rest and perhaps repentance that would unclog their ears. Surely no author would waste 200 pages defending the argument that God has a mute button. Those 5 days changed my life. In a prayer cabin with only a wood stove, chopped wood, and an oil lamp, I read through the entire Bible and answered my question without a doubt. No, God is never silent. I found plenty of verses that put the burden back on the shoulders of mankind, such as, "If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me," Psalm 66:18. But I found nothing to imply that God becomes deaf and mute and withholds his counsel when we are walking uprightly in him. Psalm 50 verse 3 even says, "Our God comes and will not be silent." That was answer enough for me. God will not be silent. There was a period referred to as the 400 years of silence that took place between Malachi, the very last of the Old Testament prophets, and Jesus' birth. But both Jews and many Christian groups view this period as one in which the prophets were silent nationally, but not as a time when God himself was silent. Luke 2:36 mentions that the prophetess Anna was very old at the time of Jesus' birth, so clearly God was still speaking and prophets and prophetesses were still prophesying during those 400 years. God did not speak scripture during this time, but he spoke individually and congregationally. Likewise, God did not speak scripture during the time humankind was in the Garden of Eden, but he was still speaking. In fact, he has not spoken scripture for more than 19 centuries, but he has still been speaking. He will not be silent. So then, if God is never silent, why did it seem as though God was not speaking to my family and me lately? We had scraped the sides of our hearts clean 100 times, humbly seeking him. And then it hit me. If you have done the last thing God told you to do and are hearing nothing new, then you are perfectly within his will and can relax until the next step comes. We had, and we did. To this day, I hold that cabin journal in my hands and marvel at what God did during that great fall. A quote from my journal says, "I believe these 5 days in God's Word are key days in this fall saga. I am expectant at what God will do during this season, at who he will be for me for the first time, and who I will become in him that will affect my lifetime." That woman was right. Through a dream, he had used her eyes to open her ears. He wants to do the same for you. 4 eyes and 4 ears. Every Christian has 4 eyes and 4 ears. You are given one set when you are born and another set when you are born again. Through prophetic dreaming, God can communicate direction to you that perhaps you would not be able to hear while awake in your distracting environment. This is the entire basis behind the idea of this book about seeing the voice of God, because it involves communication without speech. We all know it is possible to communicate without words. Baseball players do it, participants in a game of charades do it, animals do it, even babies do it. Why, then, should God be limited to using only our ears to communicate with us? Did he not also give us 4 other senses with which to experience him? He can speak to us through touch, taste, smell, and most certainly sight. He created them all, and everything He created is intended to help us comprehend Him. And besides, just as in my waterfall dream, oftentimes dreams do contain spoken words, so the spiritual ears are engaged. It is as if through dreams, the person who claims to have a hard time hearing God's voice suddenly hears with undistracted precision. Job 33:14-18 confirms this. For God may speak in one way or in another, yet man does not perceive it. In a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falls upon men, while slumbering on their beds, then He opens the ears of men and seals their instruction, in order to turn man from his deed and conceal pride from man. He keeps back his soul from the pit and his life from perishing by the sword. In a dream, He opens the ears. There you have it. We can hear with our eyes. Thus, dreams are an essential tool for people who question their ability to hear the voice of God. Visions, too. I often find that when people say they cannot hear God's voice, they are actually seers in training and do not know it. It is as though God is bypassing their ears and going straight to their eyes, which may become their strongest line of communication with Him. They have an enhanced prophetic eye through dreams and visions, and God wants to grow them in that. Well, as you can tell by now, I believe that God wants to speak to you at night. If you are someone who works at night and sleeps by day, these promises are still just as much yours. If we spend a third of our day in bed, and thus a third of our life in bed, then that means a 60-year-old woman has been asleep for 20 years of her life. With this math, it means that you yourself are asleep about 122 days out of every year. Why would God waste so much of your lifetime by being out of touch with you during those precious hours? If God wants to speak with you during the day, then of course He wants to speak with you at night. Does God sleep at night? No. Psalm 121:3 says, "He who watches over you will not slumber." And the first chapter of Genesis records God saying, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." Notice the wording, "our image and our likeness." He is already referring to the Trinity in the first chapter of the Bible. We see that just as God is made up of three parts, then we, being made in His image, are too. We have a body and a mind, and they both slow down at night and rest. But we also have a spirit, and it never sleeps. It is the part of us that is like the one who, as we established, will not slumber. Our spirit is awake all night long, longing to convene with God. I like to think of it like a fulfillment of Song of Solomon 5:2. I sleep, but my heart waketh. It is the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, "Open to me." I often pray that verse over myself when I go to bed. Lord, You are my beloved. I am going to sleep, but my heart is awake, listening for Your voice. I expect God to speak and minister to my spirit each and every night in some creative way. Why would He just tuck you in at bedtime and move on to ministering to people who are awake in other time zones? Deuteronomy 31:8 says, "He will never leave you nor forsake you." Doesn't that pretty much mean never? Not even when you sleep? On the fourth day of creation, why didn't He just skip over the invention of nighttime and never make a moon or stars? I tell you, nighttime is God's idea. It belongs to Him, and He is busy during it. The problem may be that many of us are dismissing our dreams, in which case the dreams will begin to cease coming. But look at the first part of the Job 33 passage again. For God may speak in one way or in another, yet man does not perceive it. Verse 14. We see here that God does speak through dreams and visions, but many people do not perceive it. Perceive is a verb that means discern, appreciate, consider, realize, recognize, become aware of, see, distinguish, grasp, understand, take in, make out, find, comprehend, apprehend, sense, figure out, regard, and view. Let it never be said of you that God speaks, but that you do not discern, appreciate, consider, or realize it. What a shame that would be for the creator of the universe to have something to say to you and say it, only to have you disregard it as a pizza dream. With that mindset, the entire mysterious book of Ezekiel and all of its illogical, disorderly symbols could easily have been attributed to too much pizza. The Lord often chooses to speak obscurely, with seemingly unintelligible symbols, so that we must seek Him for interpretation. And we'll discuss that further in chapter 7. Two streams. Best-selling author James Gall makes a brilliant comparison between the Nile River and the prophetic flow of God on earth in his book, The Seer, The Prophetic Power of Visions, Dreams, and Open Heavens. Although the mighty Nile is the longest river in the world at about 4,100 miles long, it begins its life as two separate rivers, the White Nile, which flows from Tanzania, and the Blue Nile, which springs from Ethiopia. Gall likens this to how God's prophetic ministry over all on earth is fueled by two streams, the stream of the prophet and the stream of the seer. What is the difference? Well, in a multifaceted answer, Gall writes, "All true seers are prophets, but not all prophets are seers." He adds, "When it comes to a prophetic revelation, a prophet is primarily an inspired hearer and then speaker, while a seer is primarily visual." In other words, the prophet is the communicative dimension, and the seer is the receptive dimension. Hence, one stream involves the ears, and the other the eyes. I include Gall's river parallel because it undergirds my sole ambition for this book, Seeing the Voice of God. His analogy applies to the offices and ministries of prophet and seer churchwide. However, whereas my points are more applicable to your individual life, you have the ability to both see and hear spiritually. Those are two streams flowing back and forth between your spirit man and God. But in seasons when you feel God is silent, or we are in geographical regions where hearing God's voice is difficult due to territorial strongholds of evil that seek to hinder His full reign, we can still see the voice of God through dreams and visions. We all sleep. We all dream. Science proves this, and we will explore medically in chapters 4 and 5 how to improve our dream recall so that we can better steward what God might be trying to communicate to us. When your ears fail you, the eyes have it. When one stream temporarily dries up, the other still flows, and oftentimes floods. This is my personal testimony. When I found myself in the greatest hearing war of my life by day, my eyes opened at night through dreams, so much so that I began to see, not only for myself, but for other people. And then ministry was birthed. While God was healing the dry spell in my other stream, my seeing stream began to gush. Even the physically hearing impaired will tell you that their eyesight becomes sharper to compensate for their deafness. Not that they have better vision than hearing people per se, but they learn to use and rely on their other senses better to compensate. Likewise, a hearing drought is the perfect time to ask God to open your eyes. Many times those dreams and visions that come forth lead right back to open ears. Remember Job 33:15-16. In a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falls upon men while slumbering on their beds, then He opens the ears of men. The sixth sense. The New Oxford American Dictionary defines sixth sense as a power of perception like but not one of the five senses, a keen intuitive power. I guess I disagree that we even need a sixth sense. Are not the five senses that God gave us amazing enough? Can we not use them for constant communication with Him if we are seeking Him? In chapter 10, we will explore how God sharpens these senses further with the gifts of His Holy Spirit as we mature in Him. But even now, as that maturity is in the process of developing, your natural five senses are longing to experience Him. What are you waiting for? Here are some examples of God Himself using these remarkable five senses in His relationship with humankind. Sight. God saw all that He had made, and behold, it was very good. Genesis 1:31. Sound. God heard their groaning, and He remembered His covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. Exodus 2:24. Smell. The Lord smelled the soothing aroma. Genesis 8:21. Taste. When Jesus had tasted it, the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." John 19:30. Touch. God touched the hearts of certain brave men who went along with him. 1 Samuel 10:26. And here are some examples of humankind using these five senses in relationship with God. Sight. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Matthew 5:8. Sound. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. John 10:27. Smell. But thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him in every place. 2 Corinthians 2:14. Taste. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalm 34:8. Touch. And all of the people were trying to touch him, for power was coming from him and healing them all. Luke 6:19. I do not think we need a sixth sense as the world defines it. I think the Holy Spirit can make our five senses naturally supernatural all day long and communicate with us enough to draw us to himself. Of course, we not only want to communicate with him, but for him. And that is where our spiritual senses come into play, which we will discuss in chapter 10. Prophecy, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, and others. But even when we are walking in the Spirit and fully employing those spiritual senses, God still can use the five natural senses he has given us with which we experience him. One angle. I have no idea where you are in your walk with God or if you even believe in him. I have no way of knowing if you eagerly bought this book or if an insightful friend gave it to you. When authors write, they first establish an audience in their heads that they can easily speak to, a specific population of people they have in mind. But in this case, even after writing a full chapter, I still cannot discern who that demographic is for this book. It is as if I cannot narrow it down. I see the faces of some of you who have spent a lifetime loving God, yet I see others who revere him at a distance but need persuading that he really wants to say anything specific to them, or they are scared that he might. Then I see others who are intrigued by the theme but put off by all the scripture. What we all have in common, and therefore the angle from which I will write, is that we all want to know and be known. And whether this book is too churchy for you or not churchy enough is secondary to what we might accomplish together by the end of it. I find myself in a risky position writing this book, because while I know that it is going to bring purpose and revelation to countless fledgling seers all over the world, I also run the risk of being crucified by all those whose eyes are shut. I am in danger of upsetting any Christians who do not believe that seers still exist, and in danger of upsetting the lost who do not believe that Christ exists. It is my prayer that both camps will listen and learn, because by the end of this book, I believe they both will see undeniably that not only is Christ still alive, and not only is he desiring to communicate with us, but that he is raising up a generation of sharp-eyed seers in a spiritually deaf world. The prophet Joel foresaw this generation, prophesying, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my manservants and on my maidservants I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy." Acts 2:17 and 18. Also Joel 2:28 and 29. The Apostle Peter, familiar with Joel's prophecy, reiterated it as he saw its budding fulfillment in Jerusalem almost 2,000 years ago. The pouring out has begun. The stewardship of it has not begun in full, although some in the prophetic community are doing a great job of teaching their hearts out in an attempt to see the outpouring governed well. If overmanaged by those who view dreams and visions as a messy threat to a tidy gospel, the outpouring is quenched. But if undermanaged by sloppy, self-appointed prophets, dreams and visions are left up to the seer's own interpretation and quickly become confusing, unedifying, and even psychic in nature. Let me state forthrightly that you do not need a dream or a vision to believe the Bible. If you feel you do, something is missing in your heart toward God, and it might just be His Son. If Jesus is in your heart as a result of a definitive invitation to Him, but you still feel the Word of God is not illuminated when you read it, then your issue is not with Christ, but with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit does not just seal you on the day of your salvation and retire. He wants constant communication with you. That includes dreams and visions, yes. But should the content of one ever stray from what God's Word teaches, it is not from Him. You were made in the image and likeness of God, the all-powerful one and creator of all things supernatural. So it is perfectly normal for you to desire powerful supernatural encounters. Sadly, though, people equate communication with God as a supernatural encounter, when really, it is just your birthright as His child. As we move forward, please lay aside all preconceived mysticism relating to dreams and visions. Also, lay aside any critical thoughts suggesting that teaching such as you will find in these pages seeks to replace God's Word with supernatural encounters. Encounters like dreams and visions do not compete with God's Word. They complement it. In this book, you will find biblical teaching on how to hear God's voice and also on how to see God's voice through dreams and visions, which comes in particularly handy when you feel your spiritual ears are failing you. You will read information from doctors about sleep and dream cycles, and also learn which vitamins and minerals are beneficial for improving your dream recall. You will learn what a prophetic dream is and what it is not, as well as how to classify it from one of 10 biblical categories so that you know what to do with one when it comes. You will study dozens of dreams in Scripture and hear modern testimonies of vivid dreams that were fulfilled with utmost accuracy. You will get to scan a dream dictionary that will help make sense of the symbols in your visions and dreams, since revelation without interpretation hinders application. You will learn how the life of every believer in Jesus must include a hunger for the constant filling of the Holy Spirit in order to accomplish holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. This applies to seeing in dreams and visions, too. You will also discover how that environment of hunger opens the communication lines between you and heaven, resulting in 20/20 hearing, and even fostering angelic visitations. But remember, seek the giver and not the gifts. For if you seek the gifts themselves, the enemy will make sure to hand deliver to you every counterfeit he can conjure. You will hear in chapter 10 from a former psychic who will describe his experiences in that lifestyle. He will explain what the prophetic flow of revelation feels like in comparison to the psychic flow, and describe how the successes he had in spellcasting brought him a revelation of the power in his words, a biblical truth that remains with him today as he serves God and seeks to be His voice to the lost and dying. As you read the words of this book, I pray the prayer of Elisha over you from 2 Kings 6:16-17. "Don't be afraid," the prophet answered. "Those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And Elisha prayed, "Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Life gets tough, but when God opens your eyes to the spirit realm, it changes everything. Your courage in fearful situations increases. Your ability to make wise choices increases. Your tolerance of heart to get along with people increases. And your ability to trust God and discern the spirits that oppose Him increases. And as these eye-opening experiences heighten with your reading of this book, including having more dreams and visions, I urge you to begin keeping a lookbook, which is a journal of all your seeing encounters, both sleeping and waking. Finally, if this book is in your hands, it is not by chance. I have been praying for you and probably even did so this very morning. Yes, it is full of Scripture, because in the end, God's words will do more for you than my words. He is the author of authors, so in my book, His book has final authority. How did people in the Bible interpret their dreams without a Bible to guide them? In the end, it all came down to relationship. They knew and were known by the living God, with whom they had a relationship. They learned to hear and see His voice with the Holy Spirit's help. And most important, they applied faith to what they had heard and saw and let it interrupt their lives. You will have to do the same when reading this book. It is so very simple. God loves you. He is intimately concerned with the details of your life. If you will let Him, He wants to help you navigate through life and dodge the detours. When dodging a detour is impossible due to the will of another person whose disobedience to God is affecting you adversely, He wants to help you navigate through the emotions of that situation and get back on course. But it all begins with a relationship with Him. If you have wholeheartedly come to the Father through His Son Jesus, you should expect to communicate with Him daily and nightly. You should be hearing Him with your ears during the day and with your eyes at night. If you are not, then I truly believe that this book will provide both the diagnosis and the cure for your spiritual deafness and blindness. Because within its pages are enough scriptures and testimonies to convince even the greatest skeptics that God is never silent and that He is, in fact, unceasingly trying to communicate with us. And here's my poem for you. Common Senses. You came into my heart that day. I knew it in my head. But now mere knowledge will not do. I need your touch instead. I want to see your voice at night and hear it in the day. I want my feet to not retreat, but briskly to obey. I want to feel your gentle touch. I want you to feel mine. I want your personality to cause my face to shine. I want to see your smiling face each time my faith's been great, and taste and see how good you are whenever it's been late. Where once I gave my heart to you and felt it come alive, today I dedicate to you my senses, Lord, all five. Let's pray out loud together and just repeat after me. God, thank you for wanting to communicate with me. I want a deeper relationship with you, and I invite you into my heart for a 24/7 experience that allows me to hear your voice by day and see it by night. Jesus, you say in John 10:27 that your sheep know your voice and follow you. So today I call myself your sheep and call you my shepherd. I vow to follow you whether waking or asleep. Lord, thank you for my four eyes and four ears and for how you have equipped me to comprehend your will for my life with all of the five senses you have given me. Oh God, open the eyes of my heart. Open the ears of my heart. Use both streams flowing from your throne to hone my senses. Forgive me for where I have not perceived that you were speaking, especially in dreams and visions. I vow no longer to dismiss, despise, or dread the prophetic gift. Ground me in your word, Lord. I vow to also use my eyes to study it more. In Jesus' name, amen. And right now, I release and impart to you the ability to perceive when God is communicating to you and the desire to seek Him quickly. Now open your hands, shut your eyes, and receive it. Chapter 2, When Your Dreams Are For Now, 5 Types of Prophetic Dreams for the Present. Now that hopefully I have convinced you that God is never silent and that you can hear Him with your eyes, let's discuss the various types of dreams He will give you. If you already have a journal full of dreams, now you will know how to classify them so that you can determine what to do with them. If prophecy announces something, then a prophetic dream is merely one where God is announcing something to the dreamer. Over the years, I have found biblical support for 10 distinct categories of prophetic dreams, but I have found that some of these nocturnal announcements are for immediate application, while others need to be marinated in prayer and patience. In this chapter, we will discuss 5 types of the former, and then in chapter 3, we will look at 5 types of the latter. At the end of each of these chapters, we will pray together for such dreams to come more often. It is also important to explore the physical obstacles that could prevent them from coming at all, and we will do that in chapters 4 and 5. For each prophetic dream type, I will give a biblical example, but I will also give some personal dream examples along the way, helping us take this from mystical to practical. Are you ready? Let's take a look at the 5 categories of prophetic dreams that are for immediate application. Number 1, waking dreams. If waking dreams were punctuation, they would be an underscore because they are very significant and stress importance. I absolutely love waking dreams. There is no escaping their imprint on your day. While the categories that follow are types, waking dreams are more about timing. They occur just as you awaken for your day. They are not dreams that wake you up in the middle of the night, after which you return to sleep. These dreams happen after the night's rest. They are your first impression of the new day, which is why I usually say they require action. The purpose of waking dreams is to show you something that stays with you and is not forgotten when you wake up. We all know it is possible to dream in the night and not remember it, but it is next to impossible to forget a waking dream. I often find that when God awakens me with a dream in the morning, I am to take action soberly, sometimes to pray patiently, and sometimes to apply it to my life immediately or to someone else if it is for another person. The bottom line is that you cannot shake the feeling that a waking dream is an immediate assignment. Genesis 41, 1 through 7, describes Pharaoh's 2 compelling and abstract dreams that saved a nation and preserved God's chosen people through Joseph, the obedient dreamer and dream interpreter. Verses 7 and 8 describe a waking dream perfectly. Then Pharaoh woke up. It had been a dream. In the morning, his mind was troubled. The first dream was not a waking dream, and no emotion was recorded. The second dream, however, left Pharaoh troubled. Dreams you have just before you wake up leave you feeling definite emotion. They will either trouble you into action or encourage you into peace. Pharaoh was troubled, but not for long, because Joseph's interpretation brought peace. 7 bad economic years were on their way, but 7 plentiful ones would precede them so the nation could store up and prepare. Pharaoh's first dream, followed by a second, a waking dream, drove home the point, and 14 years later the nation was back on track. Although I have waking dreams weekly, or even more often, God is bringing to mind 2 in particular. One time I had delayed returning a friend's call because I was frustrated with her. The longer I put off the call, the harder it was to make, not to mention that she was sitting over there worried sick about our relationship. Finally, one morning, I awoke to a dream that I walked out of my bedroom and she was sitting right there, outside my door, waiting patiently. No escaping her now. I knew God was saying to call her first thing. I am so glad I acted on that dream, because during our call, my friend described a vision God had given her that I really needed to hear. In it, she saw me in new glasses, and I was ministering on television to a large audience. And I had indeed bought new glasses since seeing her. What minister would not be happy about that vision? That is one example about how a waking dream can be both a sign and an assignment, and I am so thankful I obeyed. Another example was when I was executive producer and senior editor of our church's weekly television show. Each Tuesday, our drop-off deadline at the station loomed over my head like a gauntlet. If I went to bed at all on Monday nights, it was late. This particular Monday night, I had finished editing just before midnight, which was early, pressed export, and gone to bed, knowing that the typical multi-hour process would be completed as I slept, and that I would awaken to the finished high-res megafile. I rolled into bed exhausted and looking forward to a full night's sleep, only to be awakened the next morning by a dream a full hour before the alarm was set to go off. In the dream, my longtime friend Susan was standing at my bedroom door. "Laura, wake up. Wake up, Laura. Wake up right now," she said softly. When I opened my eyes, I knew immediately that something had not gone as planned and that God was awakening me so that we would not miss our deadline. Sure enough, I went to my computer and saw that the application the project was being created in had frozen during export. I got busy and finished within 15 minutes of our deadline, and the television studio was 15 minutes away. We made it under the wire, and I laughed at how God had let me sleep until the last possible moment, proving that He cares about my rest. Why did He choose this particular friend for the dream? She is perhaps the most punctual person I know on the planet. Punctual and precise and calm. Her unemotional face and relaxed tone set the mood for the morning, and through a waking dream, gave the emergency a happy ending. Number 2. Decision dreams. If decision dreams were punctuation, they would be a question mark. Why? Because a decision dream is where you are asked a question or given options, and you watch yourself provide an answer or make a choice. To me, this is the greatest proof we have that we are made up of three parts. Your mind is turned off at night as your body rests, and neither can help you make a decision in your dream. But your spirit can. Your spirit does. Watch carefully the choices you see yourself make in your dreams, for they are very telling when it comes to what is going on in your spirit, good and bad. Biblically, we see this in the famous story of Solomon in 1 Kings 3. We credit Solomon with being the wisest man in the world, all because when given one wish, he asked for wisdom and made the right decision. But did you know he was asleep when he made it? It was a dream. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask, what shall I give you?" Verse 5. Solomon's spirit chose correctly, and he asked for wisdom to lead God's people. I have no doubt that since that same spirit remained in him when he was awake, he would have given the same answer any time of day. Perhaps the most compelling decision dream I have ever had was when I, too, was faced with a sobering question and saw myself answer it. I was standing in a dark room, almost an underground cave-like space, and the prophet Elisha walked around the corner toward me. I somehow knew that the cloak he was wearing was the one Elijah had thrown down when he left this world in that now-famous chariot of fire. It was his sign to Elisha that he was leaving a double portion of his spirit to him. As Elisha approached me, I stood very still, until finally we were standing face to face, about 2 feet apart. He looked about a half foot taller than my height of 5'2". Then he asked me a point-blank question. "Will you take a vow to pray for America?" Without hesitation, I answered yes, and with that, he said to kneel in front of him. Taking his staff, the same miracle-working staff he had sent with Gehazi to raise the little boy from the dead, he placed it on my shoulder, almost as if he were knighting me. There were no words, only the anointing. I never saw myself get up off my knees before I awoke, which probably symbolized my vow to pray without ceasing. I was shocked on many levels. I also had many questions. Why me? Why Elisha? Why not Jesus? Why the shoulders? My investigation began in Scripture with Elisha. He was a prophet, and I had always identified with the lifestyles, instincts, and reactions of the biblical prophets. Secondly, he had asked for a double portion. And in 1997, a couple of years before this dream, double portion had been prophesied over our family. Twins became the recurring prophetic word spoken over us by visiting ministers and even by total strangers, and I eventually stockpiled more than 40 prophetic words about double portion and twins. It became hilarious to our friends when these ministers would come to speak, and we would get called out of a crowd for prayer, and at some point, the words double portion or twins would come out. One time, Jill Austin, a Kansas City prophetess whom God used as a mouthpiece all over the world, said it in front of the whole congregation. Then she paused and added, "No, it's a double-double, quadruplets." The promise for double portion was so strong in our spirits that it was doubling itself. We just knew we were going to have twins physically, and we already had 5 children. When I became pregnant the 6th time, we were shocked that I did not deliver twins. But then, 10 years later, our oldest married daughter made us the grandparents of, you guessed it, twins, Avery and Ezra. Those precious bundles of blue became a symbol for our whole family that the double portion promise was for our legacy too, not just for Mom and Dad. Our lives were and still are defined by double blessing, double productivity, and double portion. We even see it already in various packages in the homes of each of our married children. While I would have loved to have been standing face to face with Jesus in my dream, I knew exactly what Elisha represented. and the fact that he was already wearing Elijah's cloak symbolized that he had inherited the double portion mantle and was able to impart it to me. As for the shoulders, they represent a sense of responsibility or burden to carry. See Psalm 81:6. Shoulders also can indicate rulership or authority or symbolize government. Isaiah 9:6 prophesies that the government will be on the Messiah's shoulders. I knew, therefore, that the call to pray for America in the dream included praying for our government officials. So I do to this day. Number 3, encouraging dreams. If encouraging dreams were punctuation, they would be a smiley face emoticon. There is nothing like an encouraging dream to revive your heart and replenish your soul. This type of prophetic dream gives you an affirmation or perhaps a glimpse into a future blessing or victory. Look at Judges 7:13-15. And when Gideon had come, there was a man telling a dream to his companion. He said, "I have had a dream." To my surprise, a loaf of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian. It came to a tent and struck it so that it fell and overturned, and the tent collapsed. Then his companion answered and said, "There is nothing else but the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. Into his hand God has delivered Midian and the whole camp." And so it was, when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation, that he worshipped. He returned to the camp of Israel and said, "Arise, for the Lord has delivered the camp of Midian into your hand." Okay, be honest. If you had a dream about a tumbling barley loaf, would you interpret it to mean victory in battle? This proves that odd symbols can edify when interpreted well. If I saw a loaf of bread tumbling into my house, I would think that my provisions were about to increase or that I was about to receive a financial blessing, as in dough or bread. But if you yourself dreamed about it, it might have a whole separate interpretation, such as a reference to cooking or maybe to Jesus as the bread of life. But for Gideon, it meant victory, and it made him bow down and worship God even before the battle began. And he was not even the dreamer or the interpreter, just the overhearer. The story has 3 players, and all of them were encouraged. In addition, a whole nation was saved through the bravery and courage that came through a prophetic dream that encouraged them to get up and fight. I cannot begin to count the hundreds of encouraging dreams I have had. I remember once during a dark time when I felt there was no fruit or answered prayer in my life. Chris and I pulled all the kids close one night and had a big slumber party, all 8 of us in a big dog pile on the floor. The next morning, I had a waking dream in which I was looking down over this room we were in with an aerial view. The entire floor was covered with fruit. I mean, from baseboard to baseboard, piles and piles of fruit were everywhere. Instead of my kids in their sleeping bags, there was fruit salad. It was God's way of reminding me that those children were the best fruit I had ever had, and that I was already a fruitful woman, even if I never had another prayer answered. And it was not just 6 pieces of fruit I saw as I hovered. I am telling you, it was hundreds of pieces of fruit of every variety. So I knew and still know this represented my grandchildren and great-grandchildren. It gave new meaning to be fruitful and multiply. To this day, it is why I guard my children's lives, callings, attitudes, and personal standards of conduct and holiness with such fierceness. There are many other reasons too, but this hovering image I cannot shake and never will. Even if my adult children are tempted to feel they no longer need my guardianship, and even though other moms are glad when their kids move out and do not need it, I will always guard my children attentively. In God's eyes, from His aerial view, they and their children after them are evidently on the floor of my house forever. I also remember many encouraging dreams that came during some trying years of my life when I was plagued by constant, unexpected, and very violent convulsions. Once, I dreamed that I was in a hospital bed, and David came to visit me. He never told me who he was, but somehow I just knew. Sometimes as the dreamer, you will know things in your knower, as I have often jokingly explained to others who are growing in dream interpretation and discernment. But aside from that knowing, David was also just as Scripture described him. Now, he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome, 1 Samuel 16:12. Ruddy as in red hair, and yes, he was so very handsome. I had never thought of him as anything but King David, yet in the dream he was not a king. He was just David paying me a hospital visit. He came to my bed and leaned over with a wide, winsome smile. Squinting his eyes, he said, "I am so proud of you." Coming from such a famous warrior and worshiper, that meant a lot. It encouraged me to get up and keep warring and worshiping and trusting. My journey towards freedom from those convulsions was a long road. Before they ended, I often recounted that hospital visit from David Dream for encouragement. I will know those brown eyes in heaven one day for sure. Another time when I had been badly bruised after a seizure, I awoke after a dream about Dwight Eisenhower. I saw him in his army attire, his jacket loaded with colorful medals. Why on earth would I dream about Dwight Eisenhower, I wondered. I would have rather seen Jesus or the Archangel Michael, not Bald Ike. But as I researched him the next day, I discovered that Eisenhower was the most decorated war general of all time. Other countries even awarded him medals. After this dream, I knew that God was saying he did not see bruises when he looked at me, but medals. Suddenly, my bruises were colorful badges of honor, and I did not feel so sorry for myself. God said that the enemy had not wanted my health that night, but my life, and that I had won. That perspective shift turned me from victim to the victor. It made me stop complaining. It made me get up and fight like a highly decorated war general. It encouraged me, meaning I was filled with courage. I cannot tell you how often prophetic dreams have saved my life. I surely would have lain down and died many times over without seeing God's voice just at the right moment each time. His love for me sometimes makes me weak in the knees. Number 4, audible dreams, dark speeches. If audible dreams were punctuation, they would be quotation marks. The Bible refers to dark speeches in Numbers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.